Greetings. This is video number 2 in the series comparing Christianity to Islam. Let's examine the consistency of the claims Christianity makes about itself. What does Christianity say about itself? The Bible says the name of the God of Abraham is Yahweh. Where does Christianity make the claim that God's name is Yahweh? In the Old Testament. Exodus 6:3. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah, or Yahweh in the Hebrew, was I not known to them. Psalm 83:18. That men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, or Yahweh, in the Hebrew, art the Most High over all the earth. Does the Bible ever call God by a different name? Sometimes Adonai, which means Master or Lord. Eloha, which means God. Elohim, which means gods, hinting at plurality. Deuteronomy 10:17. For the Lord your God is God of gods, and Lord of lords, a great God, a mighty and a terrible, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. Now that's a mouthful. For the Lord, Yahweh, your God, Elohe, is God, Elohe, of gods, Ha Elohim, and Lord, Va'adonai, of lords, Ha Adonim, a great God, Ha'el. So you can clearly see by this one verse that the actual name of the God of Abraham is Yahweh, and there are three other terms used for God. Some are even translated Lord in English. The Hebrew text of the Word of God is consistent that the name of God is Yahweh, and does not give him another proper name. Christianity says it respects and worships the God of Abraham. Does Christianity demonstrate respect? Yes, it does. How does Christianity demonstrate respect? It treats the name of God as a holy thing. Christianity says it is the fulfillment of the promise of God to Abraham. Is this a consistent claim? Jesus said Abraham would have been glad to see his day, meaning Jesus' coming. Luke 1:68. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up an horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. And he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware unto our father Abraham. That was Zacharias, a Jew, speaking of his son John, or Yahya, a prophet of God, called by God to announce God's coming. Acts 3:13. The God of Abraham, and of Isaac, and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his Son Jesus, whom you delivered up, and denied him in the presence of Pilate, when he was determined to let him go. Acts 3:25. You are the children of the prophets, and of the covenant which God made unto your fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. Jeremiah 31:31. Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Hebrews 8:8. For finding fault with them, he saith, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. So Christianity consistently considers itself the fulfillment of the promise to Abraham, and makes accurate references back to the Old Testament. Christianity says it is a branch or offshoot of Judaism, which it considers itself linked to. Romans 11:1. I say then, has God cast away his people? God forbid! For I also am an Israelite, of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. Romans 11:17. And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree, wert grafted in among them, and with them partakes of the root and fatness of the olive tree, boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear, for if God spared not the natural branches, take heed lest he also spare not thee. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God. On them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness, if thou continue in his goodness. Otherwise, thou also shall be cut off. So Christianity teaches a message that Christians are grafted in to the tree of Israel, Abraham's lineage, by faith. Christianity says it respects the message of the prophets. Christianity validates this by including the message of the prophets in the Bible. How is this demonstrated? Verse after verse after verse says that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets. Matthew 1:22. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophets, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son. Matthew 2:15. And was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophets, saying, Out of Egypt have I called my son. Matthew 2:23. And he came and dwelt in the city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, He shall be called a Nazarene. There are more than 30 such references in the Gospel of Jesus Christ, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of by the prophets. But how could they know all these things? Jesus taught them. Luke 24:25. Then he, Jesus, said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things, and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So what questions beg to be asked and answered? Why didn't God clearly say, I have a son? In fact, God did by the prophets. David in Psalms 2:7, I will declare the decree the Lord has said unto me, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Isaiah 9:6, For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. The prophet Solomon, Proverbs 30, verse 4, Who hath established all the ends of the earth? What is his name, and what is his son's name, if thou canst tell? Jesus taught God sent messengers to the Jewish people, and that he was the last such messenger. Jesus told the parable of the vineyard owner. Mark 12:4, And again he sent unto them another servant, and at him they cast stones and wounded him in the head, and sent him away shamefully handled. And again he sent another, and him they killed, and many others, beating some and killing some. Having yet therefore one son, his well-beloved, he sent him also last unto them, saying, They will reverence my son. So what question begs to be asked and answered? Did Jesus ever say another prophet would come after him? No, Jesus did not say another prophet would come after him. Is this a consistent position? Yes, Jesus taught he was the last, and Jesus did not teach there would be another. That is consistent. What about the Comforter Jesus said he would send? Did Jesus say who the Comforter would be? Yes, Jesus said the Holy Spirit would be the Comforter. Does Christianity define who the Holy Spirit is? Yes, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God, the third member of the Trinity. Is the Christian definition of the Holy Spirit consistent with the description of the Comforter? Yes, the Comforter was already present, was known to the disciples, and could live in the disciples, and could abide with them forever, just as Jesus promised. So Christianity is consistent in the teaching that Jesus was the last messenger from God, and no other messenger would follow. Jesus said he was the resurrection and the life. If someone would believe in him, they would live again. To prove this, Jesus raised the dead by his command. Mark 5:40. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were with him, and entered where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand, and said unto her, Talitha kumi, which is being interpreted, Damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years, and they were astonished with a great astonishment. John 11:23. Jesus saith unto her, Thy brother shall rise again. And Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? She saith unto him, Yes, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. So notice, Jesus did not say, by Allah's permission, when raising the dead. Another point of consistency is to look at what Mary said. Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. Clearly, Mary, a Jewish woman, knew that God had a son, knew that the Christ would be the Son of God. Where do you think she learned this message from? From the Old Testament, from the prophets who had revealed the Son of God. Demons said Jesus was the Son of God. Satan said Jesus was the Son of God. Jesus said, I am the Son of God. God, speaking of Jesus, said, This is my beloved Son. So the Bible is consistent that every known type of spiritual being knew the spiritual reality. Jesus was the Son of God. Jesus said he would send the Comforter to continue teaching his message, and the Holy Spirit came. So what questions beg to be asked and answered? Why did Jesus say, if he did not leave, the Comforter would not come? Why was Jesus in such a hurry to leave? Wasn't the Holy Spirit already in the earth? Does anyone else fit the definition of the Comforter? Let's address these one by one.